Amen. Thank you so much. You're going to learn real quickly that I am not platform trained. So if I like start doing cartwheels, don't get scared. Just cheer me on. But Pastor Jerry and Kimberly, thank you so much. I am a result of prayers for the prodigals. So thank you. Between my mom and my dad and my brother and my sister, Yoli, and you guys, the prayers of those that were in your youth group one time long ago, you prayed not only for the ones that were close with you guys, but you prayed for the ones that were far off. So thank you for never giving up, and thank you for the opportunity to come and share not only my heart, but the heart of Jesus for the people, and especially for such a time as this. So thank you so much, and thank you for never giving up. And our chips are all in. We are all in this. We are sold out. We're completely convinced this is the way, and this is the new way. So thank you for not backing down, no matter how many are in the very beginning, but the Lord is bringing more people, more and more people. So thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you. And what an absolute honor it is to be here, an absolute joy. Yes, I am a little nervous, so if you see me shaking, just mind your own business and just let me shake a lot. Let me just shake it all out, shake it all out. But I am so honored, really so honored to be here again. I'll share a little bit of my past later, but I'm excited. I'm excited over what God has done in my life. I'm so thankful for our leaders that have helped us push us through, even in the moments that we didn't want. Jeff is really good at pushing us through, even when we don't want to push through. But thank you. Thank you, guys. But I want to bring, I do want to bring some scripture tonight. But can we pray? I know we've been praying all evening, but let's pray. Father, we thank you. Thank you so much for what you are doing. Father, we love you and we honor you. We declare that your kingdom come and your will be done tonight, Lord. Lord, would you open up our eyes and would you give us the ears to hear what the Spirit of is saying tonight, Lord. Holy Spirit, reveal Jesus to us tonight. I yield myself to you now. Holy Spirit, have your way. We love you and we honor you in the name of Jesus. Amen and amen and amen. Amen. You can clap. Yes, let's clap for Jesus. So I wanted to read a very familiar passage. We all know this. A lot of us can quote this by heart, but it is out of Psalm 1. And it says, "Blessed is the man who walks not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor stands in the path of the sinners, nor sits in the seat of the scornful, but his delight is in the law of the Lord. And in his law he meditates day and night. He shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of water that brings forth its fruit in its season, whose leaf does not wither, and whatever he does shall prosper." And I really like how it reads from the Good News Translation. "Happy are those who reject the advice of evil people, who do not follow the examples of sinners, or join in those who have no use for God. They are like trees that grow beside a stream, that bear fruit at the right time and whose leaves do not dry up. They succeed in everything that they do." And this is really what I want to hit on. "They find joy in obeying the law of the Lord. They find joy in obeying the law of the Lord, and they study it day and night. They find joy in obeying the law of the Lord." And I want to... You asked some questions last night, Pastor Jerry, and I want to ask some questions to us today. Do we find joy in obeying the law of the Lord? Do we find joy in loving him with a whole heart and loving people? Do we really find joy in abiding in the word, or is it just a checkoff list? Do we really find joy in going out and seeking first the kingdom of God? Do we find joy in forgiving others? Do we find joy in the Matthew 28:19? Do we find joy in the going and making disciples? Or is it just not our thing? It has to be our thing. If we're following Jesus, it is our thing. He said, go and make disciples, right? Go and make disciples of all nations and baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. And I really like what Matthew 28:20 says from the Passion Translation says, "And teach them to faithfully follow all that I have commanded you." Teach them to faithfully follow all that I command you to do. And the message says, go out and train everyone you meet. Go out and train everyone you meet, far and near, in this way of life, making disciples of all nations. And so do we find joy in that? And I'm here to tell you, the joy doesn't come instantly. And I am proof of that. The joy doesn't come instantly. When the Lord asks us to go do things, when we come and obey his law and his word, and we don't find that joy right away, we often want to quit. Because it doesn't feel good and it feels uncomfortable. But his word says they find joy in obeying the law. So where's that joy? It comes. I promise you, the joy comes from obeying the Lord. The joy comes from doing what he's asking us to do. It doesn't feel good in the moment. But there is a joy unspeakable that comes. There's a song. We used to sing it, Joy Unspeakable, that song. It's true. There's a joy unspeakable that comes when following Jesus and doing what he's asking us to do. We opened up our house church in 2020. 2020, that's a long time ago. That's 4 years. 4 years ago, we opened up our house church. And I did not find joy in that in the very beginning. And as a matter of fact, I wasn't even on board with it. I'm sorry, by the way. I was not on board, not at first. And I remember we had just got a business at the Ontario Mills Mall. And so we started the business. It was, we were already kind of running it. And that was exciting. That was new. That was very scary already. So I'm already out of my comfort zone owning a business inside of a mall. And then we had a conference, and Pastor Jerry began to share how the Lord was showing him to push down the ministry into homes. And when we began to hear that, that just kind of went over, well, surely that's not for us. I just got a business, and we're part of the young adults. How many young adults do we have in here, by the way? Woo-hoo! All of Beyond, we love you. We love you, Beyond. We love you guys so much. We believe in this generation. We believe that this generation is going to usher in the greatest move of God. So don't stop doing what you're doing. Don't stop following Jesus. We love you. We absolutely love you. But we were in ministry with Kimberly and Vanessa. We were in young adults together serving. So surely pushing down the ministry into homes had nothing to do with us, because we were in ministry. We were fully thriving in ministry. We were running with things in ministry. So I didn't even pray. I know. I didn't pray. I didn't. Because I really assumed, well, it just stopped for us. We're plugged in. We love our young adults. And then some time goes by, and then all of a sudden the shutdown happened. And then things are closed, and now we're having house church, you know, because we're kind of forced. Because, you know, we're watching Pastor Jerry on the screen, but still powerful. The word is the word. And we began to listen to the word, and still he kept sharing this vision of God saying, push down the ministry in the homes, push down the ministry in the homes. Oh, that's good, yeah, that's good. Not praying about it. But there was one day where I said this, you know, babe, we haven't even prayed about this. And I already know what the Lord's going to say. He's going to say no, because we're already plugged into ministry. Like, we are plugged in. Were we not plugged in? We were plugged in. I mean, we were plugged in. So, but Lord, I'm going to pray. I'm going to bring this before you. And I need you to show me. I need you to show us. If this is what we're supposed to do, you got to make it clear. Make it clear for us if we're supposed to start a house church. And I didn't hear anything. And, you know, a little time goes on and everything began to shut down. The mall began to shut down. We used to go to a conference every year. She Rises with Holly Wagner at the Dolby Theater. That was shut down. And because that shut down, they were telling people, you know, just gather in small groups and have this little conference in your home. So I said, you know what, I'll do it. I'll invite some girls over and we'll have the conference in my home. And it was Friday night and we're in worship. We're worshiping the Lord. And as I open my eyes, I see one lady over there in the corner completely, I mean, on her knees and in worship. And one over here, and then one over here. And nobody was paying attention to nothing. They were just in worship. And I looked around. I'm like, oh. And I heard the Lord say, this is your house church. And I'm like, oh boy. Oh boy. Okay. All right. Well, I heard you loud and clear. We're supposed to start a house church. But Lord, Jerry, and my, just to let you know, when I talk about Jerry, I mean my Jerry. Yeah, like I have a Jerry, Kimberly has a Jerry, but I'm talking about my Jerry. I also refer him to hot tamale, so either Jerry, Jerry Bear, or hot tamale, that's him. He's a hot tamale, hot tamale. And so I told the Lord, I said, Lord, he works hard. He's not going to want people in the house just like, let's just open up our house. Like, he works hard. So if you really want us to do this, we have to be in unity. Lord, I'm going to know when I talk to him what it's going to be. So I talked to him, and he said, well, how is that going to look? And I said, I don't know. I don't know how it's going to look, but who should we invite if we do? I'm like, why are you asking these questions? Just, you know, you work hard. You know, you don't want answers. And he's like, well, who would we invite? And I said, well, you know, I believe we need to pray about who to even invite, because if we invite our friends, they're all going to show up. And it's just going to be a hallelujah night all the time. But I think the Lord wants to bring new people that we don't know. And so he said, let's do it. I'm like, okay, let's do it. We're going to do it. And so we opened up our home. And the first person that the Lord showed me to invite was a lady from China, Wendy. She was the first person who the Lord said, I want you to invite her. So we invited her, and she started coming. Then we invited some other people, and they started coming. Not people that we didn't really know. And through the word, we began to see lives being changed just by opening up our home in the very beginning. And then the mall went back on, and so we're back at the mall. And now, I mean, we're hearing the word and hearing the word. And now these other tools are coming out, like the Jesus Church is coming out, and these other tools are coming out so we can share the word with other people. And then our eyebrow gallery, where I get my eyebrows at, her name is Mahek, and she's Hindu. And so one of our girls that was doing our eyebrows, she asked her boss, which is Mahek, hey, could we have a study? Could we have a Bible study in your salon? And she said, yeah, I always ask Christy to pray to her God for me. So yes, you could have the keys to the salon and have Bible study in here anytime. And when we began to see that, we're like, whoa, like people are really willing to do this. And then we began to invite people that we didn't know. We began to meet people at the mall, left and right. I mean, the simple conversations of just talking to people and having a relationship and knowing people. And, you know, at the mall, you have these walkers. We call them walkers. They would always walk. I don't know how they knew how to get in the mall, but they knew a secret way to get in the mall, because I'm like, you're not supposed to be here. But they would walk the mall. But we would, I mean, be able to establish a relationship. What I didn't know is a lot of them would walk around the kiosk and they would read the Bible verses. And then sometimes they would wait until we got in and say, hey, what is this? What does this mean? And what an opportunity to preach the word to them. I didn't tell them. They asked. And as a matter of fact, we think that people know about Jesus here in America. And not everybody has heard about Jesus. I had this one lady who was reading all the Bible verses that we had on the kiosk. And when she got to the one that says, by his stripes I am healed, she began to cry. And I said, hey, what's going on? Why are you crying? And she said, if I wear this, will I be healed? Is this a healing bracelet? Is this like a copper healing bracelet? She said, what are stripes? She was like my age. And I said, have you heard about Jesus? She said, no. And I said, let me tell you about Jesus. I mean, so simple. They're all around and they're ready. We began to have Bible study in the malls, in the Ontario Mills Mall. We began to we had a lot of people that would come during their lunchtime to ask questions. Hey, what does this mean? Or hey, I'm going through this. Can we have prayer? Then we would have people come to the mall and say, hey, you know what? I'm on my 20-minute lunch break. Can we read the word together? Here's the thing. I wasn't going after them. And what we learned early on, when that shutdown happened, we learned to pray for persons of peace. We learned to pray for persons of peace. And I still to this day pray and ask the Lord, send us a person of peace. I don't have to go out there and force people. You send them to us. You send those to us. Lord, prepare their hearts. When we were in our house church, and I remember the Lord clearly saying, you are obedient, but you're not being willing. I out of obedience to the Lord, we opened up our house church. And I was doing the stuff, and I was serving. I was Martha, just serving. Just don't talk to me on a Sunday morning because I'm getting everything ready for the Lord. In the name of Jesus. And then they would come and it's like, hi, how are you? And I realized the Lord had shown me, you're obedient, but you're not willing. And when the Lord showed me that, I'm like, oh God, Lord, would you change my heart? Father, would you prepare my heart? Would you give me the vision for this, for house church? Would you give me the vision for disciple making? Would you give me your heart for making disciples? I don't have it. I love people, but I can only love people so far. I need the Holy Spirit to baptize me with his love so that I can see people the way he does and I can love people the way he does. I need him for that. I thought I loved people really well, and I do, but I've got some issues still. I still got issues. So I needed him to show me, Lord, what is your heart for this? And then another study would come out, like the Jesus Church and the Jesus Way, and another study would come out, Lord, this seems hard. We got in a groove of this. Now we got to go to this. Lord, give me your heart for this. Show me your heart for this. I need your heart for your vision. I don't want to do it just out of obedience without doing it out of love. I want to do it out of love and obedience. I want to do it all. I need your heart. So there's been a constant asking the Lord, Lord, give me your heart for this. Give me your heart for disciple making. Give me your heart to see how this is going to work. We've done things one way for so long. But I know this is a new way. That's why I was desperate, because I knew this is the way. Jesus said, go make disciples. How are we going and making disciples? Lord, give me your heart for this vision. Give me your heart for the people. I need your heart for the people. Well, we continue to have Bible study at in the mall. We were having Bible study in the eyebrow gallery. We were having Bible study now in our home. It wasn't just Sunday house church. It was now Wednesday. People were asking, hey, I want to learn about the Bible. We weren't even asking them if they want to learn about the Bible. They said, I want to learn about the Bible, but I can't come on Sundays. Okay, you know what? Come on Wednesdays. We'll open up our house on Wednesdays, and we'll start having Bible study on Wednesdays. Just sharing the word, reading the word. Like, well, I didn't have to prepare a message. We just read the word. And the word began to change people dramatically, like dramatically. And so Wednesdays are coming, Sundays are coming, we're meeting people at the mall, and then I meet Carla. Carla, can you stand up so everybody can say hi? It's Carla. And actually, I have to do this too. Some of our house church family is here. Can you stand up, house church family? They're here. Stand up. That's a wild story how I met them. So wild. But that has to be for another, that has to be like session two or something. So I got to tell you about Carla. So it was during the holiday season. It was during December. And I was going to have two girls that were going to be leaving work and going on to do other things. And so in my natural, business mind, I thought, oh, I'll just call LPU or I'll call Azusa Pacific and I'll call them and say, hey, do you know anybody that's looking for a job? I'd love to hire two girls to get them in there. Because I was like, this is like the holiday season. We need someone in here right away. And that's what I was going to do. And the Lord said, no, I will bring them to you. I'm a Lord, I can text real quick. I mean, I can just make a couple emails and text messages. I can just, no, I'll bring them to you. And I said, oh. I just like a little control. Just give me a little bit of control. I'm not asking for a lot of control, just a little bit. But I heard, I knew what he said. He said, I will bring them to you. And I said, okay, all right. So I'm working the mall. I'm working there. I love the mall, by the way. I love being there. I love the people of the mall. And I'm working there, and here comes Carla. She buys something. Thank you, by the way, for your purchasing. She bought something. And then she leaves, and then she comes back around. And I remember her, and there, at that time, there's so many people, but I just remember how she was at first. And she came back and she said, excuse me, are you hiring? And I'm like, I am. And in my mind, I'm like, but not you. But here's why. Because she was so very soft-spoken, and she was so very shy. She was timid. You could just see. And so in my mind, I'm like, no. But I'm engaging with her. Like, okay, you know, you're looking for a job. I'm like, do you have a job? She's like, I have a job. Okay, strike two. You have a job, and you're too shy. So I'm not going to feel bad right now. And then I start asking her more questions. And I said, well, do you have a car? No, strike three. That's it. I am not going to hire this girl. I'm not. And then I said, you know, let me ask you a question. You have a job. You don't have transportation. You seem kind of shy. And I said, so why are you looking for another job? She's like, I'm not. I just thought it would be great to work here. She's like, I just gave my life back to Jesus. And I thought it would be kind of cool to be around this. And then I heard these words, hire her and disciple her. Those words still ring this day, hire her and disciple her. And I thought, oh, I heard that loud and clear. When can you start? When can you start? And so we hired her. And the first day she came on that job, I had our other girls that were working there. And I said, we're going to lay hands on Carla. And we're going to declare a spirit of boldness to come over her in the name of Jesus, that when she speaks, she will speak loudly and clearly to the customers, but that she will also lay hands on the customers, that she will have this boldness to rise up. And let me tell you, the Lord answered that almost immediately. She still had to walk out some of that, but that fear left in the name of Jesus. That spirit of boldness rose up on the inside of her. And now, let me tell you, I'm going to just keep talking about Carla, because through one person, and this is not in my notes, but I got to tell you this, one person, and I'm going to share with you from one person how many more people have come to Jesus. But if you would even begin to ask the Lord in your own heart, who is that one person, Lord? Show me that one person. It might be someone you know or someone you don't even know, but Lord, send me a person of peace so I can disciple. Yes, go into all the world and make disciples, but start with the one. You don't have to have a house church of 50 people. Start with the one and disciple them. And when I heard the Lord say, hire her and disciple her, I knew this wasn't just going to be, hey, let me just, you know, read a couple scriptures with you. No, it wasn't that way. She began calling me on my days off. Hey, are you coming in the mall today? Can we read the word? I wasn't coming in, but yes, I'll be right there. I'm coming in. We're going to read the word together. And she began to eat the word. And she was so hungry for the word. I had never seen anything like it. Not the way she was so hungry for the word and her heart for Jesus. To do what he says to do, even though she was, you know, a little timid at first. She just kept coming. And then she started coming to Wednesday nights at house church. And shortly after Wednesday nights, she brought a friend named Chris. Chris started coming, and he was an atheist before he even got to my house. But because Carla laid hands, she worked with him at Five Guys, or still works with them at Five Guys, burgers. But she laid hands on him during, they were having lunch together. He was having pain in his back, and she said, well, let me pray for you. He goes, well, I'm an atheist. Well, let me pray for you anyways. Yeah. Well, that spirit of boldness really got to her, you know? And so she laid hands right there in Five Guys, and that pain left his back. And so the next time she came, then Chris came. And then shortly after that, they were both baptized in a blow-up pool, like up to here. Is a blow-up pool. They both got baptized. We were in awe of the Lord. But that completely started opening up more doors for people. From there, then another gentleman comes from her old high school who just so happened to reach out. Say, I'm going to a church tonight. You want to go? Okay. And then he began coming. getting changed and getting transformed by the word of God, by being discipled. I mean, every week he's coming, every week he's coming. And then he gets baptized. And then he doesn't even tell his friends about Jesus. They're asking, what happened to you? Why are you different? Why aren't you smoking anymore? Why aren't you going out and what happened to you? He's like, nothing. I've just been going to church. Oh, and I got baptized. You know, by the way. Oh, well, where are you going? Well, we're going to a church in Ontario. A lot of them are from Riverside and Bloomington and way out there. You know where Bloomington is. It's way out there. And all of a sudden, we're about to move into a new home. And the day that we move into this new home, because we had to leave we were with our landlord for over 10 years and we needed to move. And when we moved, the day that we were moving in, we had just pushed the couch in. And here, four new young adults come. By the way, our house church is filled with young adults. The Lord wasn't done with us, with young adults. Praise the Lord. We love this generation, so he wasn't done. Our house is filled with young adults that are now going and making disciples. But these kids started coming, these young adults began coming, being transformed by the word of God. And not only are they coming, but we're now asking them, hey, would you go and do this in your home? Would you go and pray about having a house church? Oh, no. I remember asking Carla in 2022 when she started coming to house church, hey, would you pray about having a house church? Oh, no. No, I can't. There's no way. I'm like, no, I was there. I know. I know how you feel. But she's all, none of my family follows the Lord. So I don't know how that works. I'm like, let's just pray. There's no pressure. That's like my favorite words. There's no pressure. Just pray. Just pray. And you let the Holy Spirit lead you. And it wasn't a yes right away. It was a year later after I had asked her. So let's not get discouraged when we're told, no, I'm not going to do this, or no, I'm not going to do this, or even no, I don't want to take it. I don't want to go through Jesus' disciple. Don't get discouraged. Continue to pray for them. There's no pressure. Continue to pray for them. And so, well, she opened up her house church, yeah, a year later, and her family started coming. So she opened up her house church in Fontana. Her mom and dad come. Her brother and his girlfriend would start to come with their family little by little. And they just began being changed, but it felt like kind of a slow process. But we continued to pray. We started praying on Tuesday. Last year, we began praying every Tuesday night. We began praying every Tuesday night. We were going to my sister-in-law Letty's, and we began to pray for the lost that we know. We began to pray for the lost I know and the lost that they know, and then my in-laws and then our family. That's all we did. Hey, what are we going to pray? Pray for the lost. What are we going to do tonight? Pray for the lost. Let's just pray. Let's just pray. And we began to see little by little by little the Lord answering those prayers more and more. I wanted to share that a little, how we moved into the house, that little testimony. Because even that, God provides. When we're asking and we're seeking the Lord and when we're following him, he provides for us bigger and better than we can ever imagine. There is a joy in following Jesus. There is a genuine joy in following Jesus. We were with our landlord 10 years. We were with him about 10 years. And the Lord took us from glory to glory with his houses. He owns like 6 houses. And the house that we were living in was a really large house, beautiful home. And he said that we needed to be out by September of 2022. Yeah, we had to be out of 2022. And so we said, okay, Lord, well, you called us to Ontario, but we really need a move. So I'm just going to start going online. I went online and began looking. I started looking out in Riverside. I started looking out way far. And I felt like the Lord was saying, what are you doing? I called you to Ontario. Yeah, Lord, but there's no houses on Zillow. There's no houses here. So I'm just going to go a little bit further. No, but I called you here. I called you here. I said, okay. All right, let me look again. And then I heard this, stop looking. Oh, that control. Give me a little control, God. He said, stop looking. I'm going to bring the house to you. Oh, boy. Okay. All right, Lord, you said you're going to bring the house to us. I heard that. I heard it. Maybe we should stop doing house church right now. Maybe we should stop doing the whole discipleship right now. I mean, with the business and having to move, I remember calling Jeff saying, I don't think we're going to be Ontario pastors anymore because we have to move, and we have to move far, is what I was thinking at first. But then when the Lord said, no, I've called you to Ontario, then I said, okay, we're going to believe then. We're going to lock faith, and we're going to believe, Lord, that you are going to continue to provide for us here in Ontario where it makes no sense. No, you know what we can afford. You know what we have, and you know what we don't have. But we give it to you. And as I was praying, I said, Lord, I got giddy. I got like a little kid. I said, Lord, I don't know how you're going to do it, but we have to move. And we don't know where. But Lord, would you give us a pool? I asked like a little girl asking to her father, can we have a pool? Because Lord, we don't mind baptizing in the blow up pools, but they get green and slimy really quick if you don't wash them and clean them. Jerry knows because he would clean and wash the pool. And I said, Lord, give us a pool and we'll continue to baptize. I mean, we'll baptize without, but I asked, Lord, can we have a pool? And so I wasn't looking. I had left that alone. And then our ex-landlord had sent me a text message and said, it was a message from Zillow that someone had referred this listing to you. Take a look, click on it. And I clicked on it and I'm like, oh, wow. Click, 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 click. And I'm like, it's got a pool. It's a 5-bedroom. It's going for only this amount. What? No. And then the thought came, Zillow says, if it's too good to be true, it's too good to be true. So I'm like, no, I'm not going to do that. So I went about my time. And then shortly after that, I just felt the Holy Spirit just get back over there and fill out the application. Get back over there. And I said, oh, this is no way. Lord, is this ours? Lord, is this ours? And so I sent a message to the landlord and didn't hear, but why? We heard back that evening. She called and she says, and so funny, she called me Chris. Only my mom calls me Chris. And she says, hi, Chris. This is Edwina calling. And I'm just calling to let you know that it's not you and your family. I already picked a family. So I'm just calling to let you know. And I'm like, who calls just to let you know it's not you? Like, I didn't know whether to thank her or whether to be like, what? So I said, well, thank you so much for calling me and telling me it's not us. I really appreciate that. And she's like, well, I have all these other calls to call. And my phone is blowing up. It's just too much right now. And I said, so what did you decide to go with, or who did you decide to go with? She's like, oh, I'm just going with the family. I'm going to go the government way because that way I'm guaranteed my rent. And I don't want to deal with anything. And I said, oh, okay. I said, well, Edwina, just to let you know a little bit about us, not that she was asking. She wasn't asking about us. But I said, just to let you know a little bit about us, my husband and I, we have a house church. And, you know, we have a business and he works and our kids are grown adults, you know, two girls married and we have our two young adult boys. And she said, wait, back up. You have a what church? And I said, we have a house church. She's like, in your house? And I said, yeah. And she said, well, I used to go to church. I'm like, oh, really? Hey, we would love to have you for house church. And she's like, no, well, I stopped going because of COVID, which, by the way, there's a lot of people that are not going to church because of COVID. So we need to pray them back in too. And so she said, she was asking all these questions. Well, how many cars usually come? I'm like, well, it could be anywhere from 5 to 10. It really depends on how many people come for the day, the Sunday and the Wednesday. And she said, you know, listen, Chris, I called to tell you no. I called to tell you no. I'm not going to be persuaded here. I'm like, no, I'm not. And then Jerry, my hot tamale, says, just tell her to pray about it. No, seriously. And then she's like, what was that? Who said that? I said, oh, that was Jerry. That was my babe. He just said pray about it. And here's the thing. Honestly, Edwina, honestly, we don't want to be anywhere where God doesn't want us. So if it's not your house, it is not your house. There's no pressure. Seriously, there's no pressure. And if God has someone else for your home, then that's who's supposed to be there. So we don't want to nothing. She's like, well, you know, I'm going to pray about this. And I'm going to ask my family, and I'll let you know. I said, okay, all right. Next day she calls, I hope you prayed about it. I said, we did. She said, go ahead and come over and see the house. And so in 2022, in August, a month before we even had to move out, the Lord gave us this home where the rent is ridiculous. The rent doesn't make sense, but because she has like four or five other homes, this was her first home. So she really just wants someone there to maintain it. And I said, this pool wasn't here when you bought the house. She's like, oh no, not at all. We just put a pool back there. And the pool goes like, it's like this all the way across the yard. It's like this. I'm like, we can baptize a lot of people. So when she said, go ahead and come and look at the house, and you know I have a pool, right? Because you can use it for baptisms if you want. Oh, thank you. Thank you. And what happened? We began to have more baptisms. I mean, like double amount of baptisms in our home. People coming, hearing the gospel, hearing the word of God, coming and being transformed by the word of God, discipling them every week. We didn't have the Jesus disciple out yet, but these young adults were so hungry. So we took them through OSL. Oh, their flesh was screaming. I mean, screaming, but they did it. They did it. And then after that, then what? Now what? What do we do? Okay, well, we have, you know, I don't know who told me. I think maybe Pastor Caleb, you told me, oh, I wish you would have waited. I wish you would have waited. The Jesus Disciple app is about to come out, the beta testing. But they couldn't wait, Pastor Caleb, so I'm sorry I didn't wait. But they're hungry. And here's the crazy thing. We don't have all the lights. We don't have all the flash. We don't have any of that. We have Jesus. Seriously, Jesus. Now listen, we did not feel the joy in the beginning. It was hard, and still it can be hard because we have people that come and who are so on fire for the Lord, and we're watching them being discipled, and it's like, you know what? I'm going to just head on out. It's like, what? You were so changed. How did this happen? So the heartbreak that happens, but it causes us to pray all the more. No, Lord, what you finished the work that you've begun in them. I am not going to be deterred and swayed by what I see. No, Lord, we are calling them back into your kingdom. And then when these two young men that asked their friend what was different about him, and they started coming, we asked them if they wanted to get baptized. They're like, oh, no, we don't want to get baptized. We ended up going to a worship night. My brother led a worship night at Alex's house. And we're over there, we're in worship. And right after worship, they both came up to us and they said, hey, we want to get baptized. I'm like, that's great. We have a pool. Yay. So we're going to baptize both of you guys. Well, that day that they were getting baptized, Jerry and I were getting ready for house church. And let me tell you, by the way, it is a joy. It is a joy. It is a joy. It is a joy to open up our home, to have people come to hear the word of God, to be discipled. It wasn't at first. It wasn't, but I prayed and I asked the Lord, give me your heart for this vision. Give me your heart for the people. I need to see them the way you see them. I need to love them the way you love them. I want to be obedient, but show me how to be obedient. Well, these young men came and they were inviting their whole family. Like these two young men, one invited his mom, the dad, the other one invited the theas and the theos and the sisters and the in-laws and our house was about to be filled with people. And we had a hard conversation with our son. See, I don't know who in here may have prodigals, but I have two that we are believing that they're going to come to the Lord. And the Lord continues to remind me, you walk by faith and not by what you see. You walk by faith and not by what you hear. You continue to contend for them. And I got to be honest, sometimes it gets a little hard because we're over here ministering and discipling young adults, and yet our own are not being discipled, and they're not going to church. And sometimes it seems that they're very far away. And these young men were getting ready to have a house full of people. We're about to celebrate, and we have a hard conversation with our son about his soul and about his eternity. And it didn't go too well, which I thought, because at the end of the conversation, he's like, well, that's where I go, that's where I go. And I thought, oh boy. And then so he went upstairs, and again, they were not fighting, it's just, it was hard, it was so hard to hear that, well, I'm not you guys. And so he went upstairs, and I looked at Jerry, and I said, babe, I don't think I can do this. How in the world are we going to baptize and continue to pour in this generation when our own sons are not following you? It doesn't make sense. I'm like, maybe we should just kind of lay back on this. And he grabbed my hand, and he said, we had breakthrough whether you feel it or not. We had breakthrough today. Don't give up. My husband telling me not to give up when I'm usually the cheerleader in the... He's telling me, don't give up. Don't give up. And I said, okay. Oh, and then we knew the enemy was coming in at that moment. We just knew. We prayed. He prayed. And then the celebrations began to come. They came. They heard a word. We taught out of the Word of God. And then we taught about what baptism was and what the significance of what they were doing. We get the Jesus Disciple. Everything is on, available. We can print out and just share it like that with people. And Jerry opened up the floor to have any of the family members say anything. And so the dad of one of the young gentlemen stands up and he says, you know, we have been praying for our son for years. And never did we think that he would get transformed in a house church. And we've been praying and I can't believe he's going to get baptized. And we're like, yeah. And then the mom of the other young man comes and says, we've been praying for our son. We've been praying for our son, and he's going to get baptized. And we're like, yes. And for one second, the thought came in again. Yeah, but what about yours? What about yours? And as quickly as that thought came in, I heard the Lord say, will I not do for yours what I'm doing for theirs? And I got that courage up again, and I rose back up, and I rejoiced with these moms. We rejoiced with these dads over their children who gave their life to the Lord and now being baptized and discipled. Praise the Lord. We continue to see more and more transformation. And by the way, we are starting to see little glimpses of hope with our sons. Little glimpses of hope. The more conversations are happening, the more, hey, what do you think of this? And I'm like, so cool about it. I'm like, yeah, you know, that's cool, whatever. He talked to me. We had conversation. He sat at the dinner table. Oh my gosh. Little moments. And the Lord has shown me, rejoice in those victories. Rejoice in those victories. I'm doing something in their hearts. It's the Lord that does it. It's the Holy Spirit that does it. There's nothing that I can say that's going to do anything but pray over his pillow, pray over the guitars, pray over the video games, pray over all of it, pray over them. And I'm trusting the Lord that my sons, our sons, are going to come to him. But until then, we're going to continue to disciple a nation. We're going to continue to disciple people in the name of Jesus. We're called to do this. We're all called to do this. Mind you, let me go back to Carla, the one that I hired and discipled. All these other people are coming. A lot of them coming. And then not too long ago, during spring break, we had two young girls, Yari and Bridget. You guys met them one time, right? They came to house church during spring break. They received Jesus for the first time there. They had never had the opportunity, never heard about the gospel. Young adults in their early 20s. And we shared the gospel with them. They received Jesus right then and there. And then after we said, would you continue to come? Would you like to take a Jesus disciple? Would you like to do Jesus disciple with us? Oh, no, we only came this day because it was spring break. We work and we go to school. We're busy. The school was a lot for them, full-time school, full-time work. And so I said, well, what days do you have off? Thursday. Usually we have Thursdays. You guys want to come Thursday? And they're like, yeah, we'll come Thursdays. And I said, okay. let's do Thursdays. And I said, I won't take you through the territory one. Let's do a discovery Bible study. But here's the thing. I'm not going to lead it. You're going to lead it. No, I can't lead it. I don't know the Bible. No, no, no. But if you lead it, you will. Well, I don't know. No, I can't lead it. I can't lead it. Well, no, no. You both are going to take turns leading it. I'm just gonna show up in my own house, and you guys come. They have been coming every week, and we're in week. We just learned creation to Christ, and then we're in week four, where Jesus is risen, and for the first time ever, I'm like, what? Because we had just done communion with our house church family the night before, so I'm like, would you girls like to do communion? Would you girls like to do communion tonight? And one of them said, oh, I'm not allowed to. My parents would never let me. I have to go to a class for that. I said, oh, I understand. Can I tell you what the Word of God says about communion and breaking bread and what it does and what it's going to do? Yeah. Do you want to take communion? Okay. We'll take communion. And so we prayed. And right before we prayed, she had been praying and asking the Lord for a job. Well, we had prayed with her and believed that the Lord was going to give her a job. She had been looking and looking and looking for a job. As soon as she drank the cup, she got a call. And as soon as it was done, it was FedEx calling her, hey, you're hired. She's on, no way. Oh my goodness, this works. Jesus works. So it was just so exciting to see the joy on her face and the joy on Yari's face to see like, oh my goodness, this is incredible. This is absolutely incredible what the Lord is doing. What he's doing through me, he wants to do through you guys. I don't know if I've missed any testimonies, which I probably have because there are a lot more. But I did want to show you this little clip, just a small little clip. And then afterwards, I'm going to have my husband, Jerry, come up and share what God has done through Jesus' disciple and my in-laws that we had been praying for over a year. So let's watch this. Where do I go? I'll just stay. Jesus. Jesus. And I've even heard some people say in a way like, well, I want to go deep with Jesus. Follow him. You want to go deep? Follow him. Abide in his word. Pray. Do these things and he'll take you deeper than you've ever been before. You want to go deep with Jesus? Follow him. Follow him in this. Babe, would you come up and share about your day? Can you give it up for my hot tamale?
Hello, church family. This is a little uncomfortable for me, but I'm here with all my chips in, too. I do want to share about my dad. My mom, too, but I was already preparing my mom through Bible study for like a year. So the Lord is drawing people, you guys. He's preparing their hearts. And I've seen that not only in-house church and out in the streets, but even at work. I remember when I was taking OSL at work, I would leave my memory verses on my machine because I drive a forklift. And I would accidentally forget them up there. And after I finished taking OSL, the 4 weeks, a few weeks went by and a young man came up to me and he said, hey, can you leave those encouraging words up there? Because, and I was just like, wow, God is so good. Like he prepared this young man. And actually they came to our first Bible study, which was called Open House at the time that my daughter Alex did. And anyways, the other day too, I went to go play basketball with one of my house disciples here, Marvin, and he invited me for a few weeks. I didn't want to do it because I'm older and they run hard, full court. And by the way, he's really good at basketball too. I said, you know what, I'm going to go. So I showed up on Tuesday. And it's in the neighborhood, you know. You got the homeboys and some homeless people that just show up to play basketball. And I went in and I gave it all I could and I got their respect. And even after, like, God is so good, you guys, because I'm always about relationship and breaking like the ice with people. And then I know that Jesus's love would just come right in and fill their hearts. So before I left, I talked to one of the guys that kind of took me under his wing, you know, older veterano guy, and he was he actually told me like, hey bro, just keep coming. He's like, I know we all go through a lot of things in life, and you know, we different avenues in life, and we're all different, but just keep coming. And then another young man that said, yeah, I'm homeless, and I do drugs, and he's like, but when I come here, I feel like I have a family. And that the Lord's just telling me, like, man, you didn't even have to break the ice. They kind of broke the ice with you. So my brother Marvin's been talking about there's ministry there. He takes his speaker there, and he plays Christian rap. And these guys don't even have a clue that it's Christian rap. It's awesome, by the way. But so going back to my parents, my dad, he's I'm a Mexican, and he's Mexican too, but he's more paisano Mexican, you know, not Hispanic. For years, I started a Bible study with my mom, and I never, like Pastor Jessica spoke earlier in one of the breakouts, that, you know, and Pastor Jerry's talked about El Monte, how they're full of Catholics. Like, there's no Christians in El Monte. It's all Catholics, you know, and I know that. You know, like with my family, I see that they get offended when we bring Christianity to their life, because it's almost like what's the word, Mama? They're betraying their religion. And it's not even about religion. Like Pastor Jessica was saying, it's about culture. You know, they got years into this, and we can't change it over one day. You know, so relationship changes that, and the love of God changes that. So my mom and I told her, Mom, you read in Spanish, and I follow because I understand both languages. And then we would pray, basically I was discipling her, without, I guess, both of us knowing, so when Jesus' disciple came out, the way it happened was my older brother, who is living in sin, and not to judge him, but because I know of him, one day he told my mom, "Hey, Christy and Jerry, they minister to people. They love people. They have fun with people. You know, I see it on their on Christy's Instagram and media and stuff. But what about their family? My side of the family." And oh, when my mom told me that, she didn't want to tell me. But when she told me, I was really hurt. Not hurt in a sense of like, why did he say that? But in like, wow. Because we were afraid that they were going to reject us, so that sparked us up to be like, okay, again, we're going to put all the chips in it, and we pursued him, and I apologized to him too, and I asked him for forgiveness, you know, and from there, that's when we went to my mom's, and actually, I talked to my mom and dad, and they said yes. And we went, and it was Christy, myself, Carla, and Chris. And Carla does worship for us, so she was able to do worship in Spanish. And there's some pictures in there where my dad just has his head down and my mom too, and they're worshiping with us. Pastor Jerry, my dad's 76, 77, and I know that the Bible says that the Lord knew us before we were in our mother's belly. So he knew that JD, for such a time as this, was going to hit today because my dad, he knew my dad before he was in my mom's belly. And he had this appointment with the gift that was given to you, Pastor Jerry, and your team to bring it in a way, not only in English, but in Spanish and other languages, that my praying grandma that passed away did not get to see the words that came out of her mouth in prayer and came back filled. That my dad received Jesus into his heart, and he was saved. So thank you, Pastor Jerry. Thank you. So we start Territory One, and you guys, I did not know my dad knew how to read. Like, I really, it's in Spanish. My babe bought him a Bible, with the big letters, because he couldn't really see that well. So we start reading, the Jesus disciple, the love of God, and my dad's reading, and the Holy Spirit's just touching him, because he's like, when we started reading about the prodigal son, like, my dad, I never even knew that if he's even read a Bible, but all of a sudden he starts breaking down and like he can't even read no more. And he reads well, by the way, because I was like, oh my God, like, Dad, like, I didn't even know you could read. And he was reading. And what I love about couples, that stand together. This is for couples and married couples. My mom just as he couldn't read, she just stepped in and started reading with him, and brought that just the love of God, because she had already been receiving. And we kept doing it, right? And my mom would show up. My mom would have sopa, frijoles, handmade tortillas, and she just enjoyed doing that for us. But they also enjoyed the faith builders. They're getting it still, and they want to start. My sister Letty is teaming up with us for there's some times where we can't be there because of certain things, but she steps in and she's leading them too. And again, my brother David, he joined us, but the second time we went, the second week, I thought he was gonna be there, but he tried it. And he wasn't there the second week. I even went into his room really happy to see if he was there, and I was like, "Oh, where is he at?" And he skipped out the back door and went somewhere else. I think his partner probably didn't enjoy the fact that he got touched by the Lord as well. And we're still praying for him, though. I'm not giving up on him. I always call him, "Hey, bro, I love you, bro. I'm here for you." But through this Jesus Disciple app, it made it so much easier for my parents I'm kind of like my parents. Like, whenever I need stuff done, navigated on my phone, my kids always help me. I'm kind of stuck, like, in the past. Like, if I could pay my bills personally and show up to an area, I would do that. But my babe does it all on that. But anyway, like Pastor Jerry was talking about, to take the time to to tell, show, and teach so that they can tell, show, and teach more disciples and more disciples. And because if they don't know how to navigate the phone or whatever device they're on, how can they keep going? And though it may be easy for some of you that are really tech-savvy, it's not for some of us. Some of us just take a little longer, but we're willing to learn. And then going back, like even Pastor Rick, the tall gentleman, I mean, he even said, like, I waited like 39 years, though I know he could have done something, but like, this is a gift for such a time as this. One of the things I tell my babe, too, is we have Bible study, and there's nothing wrong with Bible study, but there's an urgency. And the urgency is that we know that the Lord is coming, you guys. I tell a buddy at work, my friend German, my supervisor, and I'm kind of like ministering to him a little bit. And I tell him, hey, it's kind of like us telling our kids, hey, we're going to leave for a week and we'll be back either Sunday or Monday. And if they partied and did something to the house, sure enough, Friday night, they're going to start, and Saturday all day, because they know we're coming. And I tell them, that's the way it is. The Bible says that the signs are there. Because I have a sister, I say, oh, well, you don't know when the end of the world is. I go, well, that's not going to be the end of the world. It's Jesus coming back for us. And I tell her, for such a time as this is my point, that this Jesus discipleship is happening. And it is easy to learn and to navigate everything, you guys. So that's what I wanted to talk about my mom and dad. They received the Lord, and through the Jesus discipleship, it made it so much easier to navigate and to instruct and to show them how it's done, so that they can show others. My younger sister, Letty, she was going through some hard things with her husband, and my dad and mom went to spend the night because they needed to take care of the kids because of some of that. And my sister said, Dad was praying for the kids. I've never seen my dad pray for anybody, like not even us. He'd throw the keys at us or kick us, whatever it was, but like, he was praying for the kids. That's the love of God that's reached him. His mom prayed and prayed and prayed, and her words came back fulfilled and accomplished. So thank you for the time you've given me, and God bless all you guys, okay?
Oh, I'm a blessed woman. But isn't that incredible? I mean, to see my in-laws and to see those prayers come to pass, not only from when we were praying, but I was reminded that my grandmother-in-law was praying for her son for years and died believing the promise that she would see her son come to Jesus. And she's going to be excited when she sees him up there when he goes to be with them. Amen. So just a couple last quick testimonies that in the video that I showed, I'm 18 minutes over. Oh, I'm sorry. Is that okay? Okay. I'm so sorry. I'm going to get you out. I promise. Last last testimonies. House Church went with us all together. Carla had said last year that she had it on her heart to go give, you know, to the homeless. And so I remember just telling her, well, then the Lord's going to provide supplies, you know, for us to do that. And we just kind of left it, you know, in the back burner. But all of a sudden, you know, my son Jacob and my son Josh are coming home from work with these humongous IKEA bags filled with essentials, like hand sanitizer and wash and gloves and Bibles. There's the New Testament Bibles in there. I'm like, what is this? And my first carnal mind thought, like, how much is this on Amazon? Oh, we can resell. And sorry, it was a quick thought. But then I remembered, oh my goodness, Carla's been wanting to go. Okay, so we're gonna do this packing. And then once I told House Church family, hey, we're gonna gather together, you guys, And we're going to have a packing party. We have bags and bags and bags and bags of stuff that we need to put, I mean, into, like, all these essentials into bags. Jerry's work gave us as many essentials as we want, a pallet full. And so they just kept bringing and kept bringing and kept bringing. And our living room was it not just filled with blankets and Bibles and all these things. And so we're there. We're getting ready. A packing party. Literally, they all came and we're just packing things in into these bags. And then before we leave, we out of the word, we say, okay, what does the word say about the homeless? What does the word say about the ones that don't have? What does the word say? And then we begin to read God's word. This is what he says. We're going to be glad and we're going to rejoice in this. And we're going to go out and we're not only going to just hand these out, but we're going to offer prayer. We're going to offer salvation. We're going to offer hope to these people. And so the first person that the Lord led us to was a man in his van. And we began to go up there and just pray for them. And everybody just began praying over them. And then we went out to Riverside and then met people at the park, started handing out these goodie bags, the essential bags to people that we were seeing. But then, you know, we're walking and they're already praying for people. They're praying, they're laying hands, and they're going over here and they're praying, they're laying hands. And I mean, everybody's just spread out. There's a gentleman that was doing like these army crawls on the grass, and some of the house church, I'm going to put you on blast. Jerry's like, oh, he might have something on him. Like he's, and so Jerry just goes over there and he's like, hi, are you okay? He's like, yeah, I'm just doing army crawls. I'm working out. Jerry's like, oh, I feel bad. So Jerry's like, hey, you want to drop and give me 30? You want to do 30 together? He's like, yeah, let's do 30. So he started doing push-ups. And we're like, where's Jerry at? He's doing push-ups with some random guy over there with no shoes on. So they're doing push-ups. And anyways, one of the young men, Austin, that comes to our house church too, which, by the way, is my son's friend from elementary and high school. He reached out to us because he needed hope and has been coming. He received Jesus. He's coming to be discipled, and he's getting baptized on July 10th. Or no, July 10th. My son's friend. And so when my son said, what is Austin doing here? I'm like, oh, your friend reached out to us. He wants Jesus. So we're over there, and we're ministering. Listen, me and at this time, my sister-in-law, Letty, we had the kids, and it was starting to get dark. We're like, well, you know what, Letty, let's take the kids. It's dark, and there's a lot going on here, so let's go make sure the kids are safe. It's dark, and everybody is still out praying for people. And not only that, I'm like, oh, my goodness, I'm hungry. They come back, and they said, how many received Jesus? Like five people received Jesus that on Friday night. Not only that, but the one that Jerry was doing push-ups with, Austin went to go pick him up in Riverside, and he came to house church, did not receive Jesus at the park, but received Jesus in our house church on Friday. So I'm telling you, like Jerry says, my Jerry, they're ready. Well, you say that too, Pastor Jerry. The people are ready. The people are ready. The harvest is ready. I mean, they're out there, and all we got to do is pray, Lord, send them to us. Send us persons of peace. Be led by the Holy Spirit, and he'll show you. And the last thing I want to share with you guys is that over 18 years ago, I was sitting, the sanctuary was a lot smaller, and I was sitting over here somewhere, and I was sitting there bound and addicted with meth and cocaine addiction for over 7 years. I was bound by such agony and such, what's the word, shame and guilt from the abortions I had had. The shame and guilt from the lies that I was keeping from my husband. I was bound by so many things sitting over there over 18 years ago. And I heard Pastor Jerry up here continuing to say that God set him free through the word of God, through being discipled. And although the enemy lied to me for years, even after I would hear that, but yours is worse. He's a pastor. You're not. Your addiction's worse. God can't heal you. I would still sit there and I would believe with all I had to believe that God would heal me too. I began to get discipled. I got in my word, wanting so desperately to be freed from the addiction of that cocaine and that meth. I tried so long, so many times to break free from it, and I couldn't break free from it. And then I began to ask God, Lord, show me what to do. show me how to break free from this addiction. And I heard these words, you need to confess it. And I said, but I'm not Catholic. Isn't that a Catholic thing? I didn't know the word. I didn't know what the word said about confessing your sin. I had no idea. But I said, Lord, why are you telling me to confess this? This makes no sense. What do you mean? If that's what you want me to do, show me in your word to do this. And so then he brought me to, I don't even know where it is, but all I know it says, confess your sin to one another so that you may be healed. There it is. And when I heard that, I thought, oh, listen, I found no joy. I found absolutely zero joy of listening and being obedient to God's word of how I was going to be set free and who I was going to tell. I'll tell you the whole story. One day I'll tell you the whole story, but I don't have time to go into it. But I did what the Lord said to do, and I confessed my sin. And then I confessed my sin to my husband and told him what I had been doing and where the mortgage money was going, all of it. And when I did what I was supposed to do, it was less than 2 weeks that the Lord had set me free supernaturally. Before I did what the word of God said to do, which was confess my sin, I remember going to get self-help books. I was going online to say, like, how can I kick this addiction? What do I do? And I would try that and I would try that, but I couldn't go 3 days without the withdrawal. I would begin to shake, I would begin to vomit, I would begin to feel so sick to my stomach because I was so addicted. And then another year goes by, the seventh year I'm in this addiction. I said, God, just show me what to do. Show me what, I can't continue to come hear this, what I'm hearing and remain addicted. It doesn't seem right. I can't do this. What do I do? And I heard him say, I told you what to do last year, but you didn't do it. And I said, oh my God. So I did. I stepped out. I confessed what I was doing. And within those 2 weeks, I was completely delivered and set free. No withdrawal, the relapsing, none of that. I was completely supernaturally healed. And then a year later, I started stepping into ministry. Let me tell you, don't discount yourself. Don't discount where you are. Don't discount where you've been. I was the youth that would come in one way and leave the other and go smoke behind the building. That was me. I was the youth that would come in and cause distraction in the back. I was that youth. I was causing people to stumble. I was that youth. But God got a hold of my life through his word. And I'll never be the same.